Thank you, members of the media, for being here today. In response to an arrest report purported by the local radio show, which was most likely obtained illegally and submitted by an insider at the district attorney's office and or the Utica Police Department, as this was a sealed and dismissed matter, I was in fact arrested in 2017 for breaking a cell phone during a very sensitive situation involving my fiance. At the time, my fiance was experiencing some unexplained emotional issues. Yes, I probably could have handled things differently, and hindsight is 20/20. Knowing that something wasn't right, I again left my home that evening and stayed in a hotel hoping to stabilize the situation. In my fiance's emotionally charged mindset, she in fact called the police, and as such, I was then arrested a few days later. After a period of 4 days, we reconciled our differences and sought a doctor to determine what had caused this emotional outburst. We were then informed that my fiance was in fact 6 weeks pregnant and concluded that a contributing factor to this one-time occurrence was because of some hormonal changes and obviously my inexperience in how to handle this type of situation. After this, we did a lot of research, concluding that these episodes are very common in relationships when an unknown pregnancy occurs. I take full responsibility for the occurrence, making no excuses. Today, our daughter is the best thing that could have ever happened to us. Our relationship and bond has never been better, and we couldn't imagine our life without our sweet daughter, Genevieve, who is now 9 months old. I should also mention in 2017, my pistol license was temporarily suspended, and my pistol was taken into possession because of this situation. To date, the Democratic County Judge Michael Dwyer, working alongside the Democratic District Attorney Scott McNamara, has yet to restore my license and or return my pistol timely. This one-time occurrence has not and will not occur again, nor would it affect my ability to be the best Oneida County executive that the people want and deserve. In contrast to my story, we have been informed that allegations have surfaced in which the Oneida County executive may have had an affair with a member of his staff, ultimately abusing his power as county executive and not only engaging in an affair with a county employee, but inevitably impregnating her and covering up the details and discarding his responsibility, sending this individual and their unborn to live in North Charleston, South Carolina. Not only do I find this personally disturbing, but it goes against my belief that office holders should be held to a much higher standard. If a man, any man, can't take responsibility for their own child, how can we trust that they can make decisions that impact ours? In light of this new information, I'm calling for the immediate resignation of Anthony Pacenti, and I'm imploring the county legislature, the Oneida County District Attorney's Office, as well as the New York State Attorney General's Office, to conduct an investigation into this potentially apparent act and abuse of power that has been the cover-up of this affair that may have ensued. I have seen firsthand how this administration operates and can say without a shadow of a doubt that something may have occurred. As county executive, this type of behavior and potential abuse of power will not continue in my administration. I'm also calling for the resignation of Oneida County District Attorney Scott McNamara for his discussion of this sealed and dismissed case, which was arbitrary and capricious on his behalf. He has abused his position and power to try and defame, slander, and libel my character, which goes against the fundamentals of the office in which he holds. Last week, when the county executive announced his re-election, the Democratic elected district attorney was there supporting and posing for pictures with Mr. Pacenti. And now it is now apparent that he is politically charged and condoning what appears to be potential corruption. I will be pushing the State Attorney General's office to investigate, along with the cooperation of the U.S. federal prosecution. At no point did my fiance not cooperate with the DA's office during this very sensitive situation, despite his claims. Not only does the public entrust the sanctity of the position, but it entrusts the district attorney to abide by the law and tell the truth. This did not happen, and it will not go unpunished. I am also calling for the resignation of the chairman of the Board of Legislators, Gerald Fiorini, pending an investigation into an alleged affair with the president of a local organization that is the beneficiary of a very auspicious contract involving an extremely discounted rate for leasing a county-owned property. As I hold all elected officials accountable for their actions including a potential abuse of power. I'm asking the same of the elected and non-elected representatives of the organizations that are poised to protect us, the people of this great county, state, and country. I call the Oneida County District Attorney's Office, as well as the New York State Attorney General's Office, to conduct an investigation into this accusation and either confirm or dispel these potential abuses of power. Finally, I call into question the motive of radio host Bill Keeler and his team at WIBX 950 News Radio, who have continued to besmirch my character, often obsessing about my political aspirations and now my personal affairs. He has called me names, issued false statements, and even resorted to what looks like an actionable offense. Keeler also publicly admitted to withholding this police report, waiting for an opportune time to use it as a device to discredit and defame my character. Often, Keeler not only employed by WIBX as a freelance political advertiser and operative for other political campaigns. His involvement in these situations is compromised by his outside affiliation with my opponent and or opponents. I will be forwarding these complaints to the FCC and my legal team for advice. I may also call into question Keeler's involvement into an alleged affair with an unnamed female, even having a child with this individual several years ago. I have come before you, as I always do, not only to tell the truth, but to hold individuals accountable that are in a position of power or influence. We cannot allow these improprieties to occur, especially those that are held to a much higher standard. One of the reasons I'm calling for term limits is to limit the amount of power that an elected representative assumes after so many years. Oftentimes, this power leads to poor judgment, corruption, and inevitable scandals. I'm asking the media today to do their jobs with this information in an effort to ensure that these events do not continue to occur. I thank all of you today for your time. Thank you, and God bless all of you. Questions?
What you're talking about today involves rumors of an affair with elected officials and with Keeler.
Correct. Correct.
You're calling for an investigation into an affair.
Into affair of public people of public power and public position. Yes, utilizing that position in which they've leveraged, certain things. Yes, absolutely.
Do you have any evidence that any of that happened?
We have evidence. We will supply it to the proper authorities in the because we want to protect the integrity of the case and obviously the identity of the victims themselves.
And what is
when
that
you,
evidence?
Excuse me. When you talk about the board chairman and the alleged affair, didn't that come to light several years ago when you were on the board? Did you call for his resignation then?
I did not, and it did not come to my attention until much more recent.
One more thing on the resignation of Scott McNamara, the district attorney.
Yes.
Why are you calling for his resignation?
Because he brought out what is a sealed and dismissed case and talked about things involving the case, which he obviously lied about those things, but those would only be conceivable or be able to be discussed if he knew or if he discussed issues revolving around the case, not particularly a police report. A police report and particulars of a case, like saying that the victim was not cooperative, is not what is obtained through a police report. That would be obtained through the case itself.
So regardless of looking up records that might be sealed or not sealed, do you have any proof that it absolutely was officially sealed?
To my attorney's knowledge, that document was sealed because it was a dismissed case. In New York, when a case is dismissed, given the lack of evidence, the lack of information to substantiate the claim, it is then sealed.
And regardless of whether a document or record might be sealed, can that prohibit someone like the district attorney from just talking about a case?
I believe so, absolutely.
What's background and memory about a case?
What's the point of having a sealed document if the people we've entrusted to seal that document are going to come out against you and talk about it? That is the highest form, in my opinion, of corruption when it comes to unsealing a document.
The allegation you made against Mr. Keeler, it's different in that he's a private citizen.
No, he holds public influence. He talks about me constantly. He talks about other elected representatives or candidates. He should be held to the same standard because he has a power or influence over people's decision making, particularly in this election.
You think he should be held to the same standard as like a county executive or a board of chairman of a board?
I believe
or
again,
you as a candidate for
again, based on the fact that I'm being held just as accountable and I am not an elected representative, He should be held accountable because of the position of power that he holds and influence over the people, given his radio show, the long-standing history of WIBX, and the listening viewers that listen to it daily.
Are you concerned at all that saying, putting these comments out there without any official proof, although you claim you have?
We have proof. We have names, we have dates, and we will give those that information to the authority for them to investigate. But again, to protect the integrity of the case and the identity of the victims, because let's not forget, these people are victims. They were used in an instance in which the power assumed by these elected representatives, they used their power to supersede, you know, their own personal judgment. And unfortunately, I just believe that that's wrong. We can't continue to, people of power can't continue to victimize other people, especially females.
So you're not worried at all about being charged or had any slander or libel charges or anything?
Absolutely not. These are public officials, and again, we have information pertaining to these allegations.
What does Keeler's having a baby with another woman have to do with anything,
though? Because he's brought into light a personal affair or a personal situation in which I was involved in. Again, he's a person of public influence based on his position with a news outlet, and he should be held to a much higher standard than the average, regular day, prudent person.
And you think it's the same thing as a candidate who's holding office or running for office?
Yes.
So you said that your pistol permit and your pistol, that you had a firearm at the time of this incident.
Correct.
And was that taken away as a result of the incident?
Yes, my pistol, the night of the incident when I was not at my home, was locked up safely in my safe. I do have a non-restricted pistol license, so I could carry it at any time for any reason. However, it was safely locked away in the safe. They came after we had already concluded our dismissal process. It was issued then for the police to take in possession of my pistol. My attorney has reached out to the pistol licensing office asking them about my pistol, and they state that it's in the pile and they'll get to it when they get to it.
So that's the only reason they give for why they're not giving it back at this time?
Correct.
It's just taking some time?
Absolutely.
Mr. Pacenti, I don't understand why you want him removed from office despite this personal thing that you brought up.
Because the allegations are very, very serious. And again, we do have the proof that will be submitted to the authorities.
What kind of proof is that?
Again, we have the names of the victims, we have time dates, we have lots of information that will be, again, made to the authorities, because we have to protect the integrity of the case.
And victims. Who was the victim?
The people who had the affairs with these people of power. An employee with the county of Oneida, with the county executive, that's a victim. The county executive abused his power to leverage a relationship with an employee. I can't make that any more clear. Next question.
So she came to you and says she's a victim?
Again, the particulars of the case will be withheld for the integrity of the investigation.
So why didn't you bring out this before, I guess, your allegation was brought out and made public recently?
I didn't have any reason to bring these. This information has been confirmed more recently than that.
So since Friday?
Yes.
The report regarding the alleged incident involving you, which you explained today, you're saying you gave the district attorney's office, or your fiance, as you identified her, she gave them the information that she was acting. Can you explain why she made the allegation against you and how this ties in?
Well, I believe it was in my opening statements about the fact that we were, unbeknownst to us, that she was pregnant. And so for a period of even a week or two before that, there was a lot of emotional things going on in our household that were unexplained, which I don't want to get into the details of, but it was, we just didn't know what was going on. We thought that it could be a counteraction of a medication or whatever, but the true issue was that she was pregnant. I didn't understand how to handle the situation. There were a lot of other things that transpired that were not put into that police report. And, you know, unfortunately, in her mindset, she was set on calling them that evening, in which she completely regrets today, and we've moved forward from it. It was not at no point did I strike or hit, or there was no violence in the sense that that I initiated any contact or anything like that. It was more or less that I was trying to control a situation that was at the time was uncontrollable.
She said you held her down and threatened to kill her. That's not true.
That is not true.
What were the charges that were levied against you at that time?
So it was criminal mischief for breaking a cell phone, and it was harassment for, as he says, for pinning her down.
And what was the date of that incident?
That was back August 14th, 15th of 2017.
Just to clarify again, in case you already did mention this, but what was the basis for why the charge was dismissed? Or how did that ultimately unfold?
Well, with my attorney and with the cooperation of my fiance, we talked about what had transpired. We actually had told the attorney, which was then articulated to the district attorney, that we found out that there was a pregnancy involved. At that point, they kind of put it all together. We put it all together. There was no evidence to conclude that I had done something wrong and that I should be punished for it. And it was dismissed. And like I said in my statement, my fiance was 100% cooperative with the district attorney's office. In fact, trying to reach them directly throughout that particular process.
The timeliness of the allegations that you claim to levy against other officials in the area, including Bill Keeler, does it have anything to do with your response to what he had discussed on his radio program?
No, I think that as when allegations surface, like they did about me, when the radio comes out and makes these allegations and the public then either takes a position on it, they also sometimes then alert you of other things about maybe your opposition, or they alert you of other improprieties that are out there, and that's exactly what had happened.
So there was not an allegation made. We asked for your response on an arrest report that we had. We did not make an allegation against you.
Thank you for the clarification.
Can I ask a question as well? So since Friday, you've received confirmation on an affair involving the county executive, the chairman of the board, and radio host Bill Keeler. These all came to you since Friday.
Yes.
From who?
Again, we're going to protect the integrity of the investigation, and the information will be given to the authorities.
So do you still plan on filing a civil suit against WIBF?
That's up to my legal team. So right now they're discussing that. They're discussing what led up to the radio host's submission of this police report, the fact that he withheld this documentation. Mr. Menansky has asked me several times, and it sounds as if they're a little intrigued by the fact that this information came forward. The problem that basically he may be alluding to is the fact that Bill Keeler had this knowledge of this document apparently since my last election and withheld it until an opportune time to bring it out to try to discredit my campaign.
Is it your belief that it was the district attorney who provided
it? We don't know, but as a sealed document, there's only certain people that have access to that document, and that would be somebody of a much higher position. Usually a judge would be the one to unseal it, but the authorities would have to ask for the information itself.
So you're saying that it was somebody in the district attorney's office?
We don't know that for sure, but we are led to believe that, again, somebody of power did that. And for the district attorney to be that knowledgeable about the case, that forthcoming with information when asked off the cuff, that certainly alerts us that there's definitely some improprieties there.
Is it possible that the DA could have asked his staff, what was this case all about, look into it, let me know what was going on, and then, which normally I've talked to Scott in many cases, that typically what happens. He might not have firsthand knowledge right at that spot, but he's very good about looking into things and finding out. If that unfolded in this case, what's wrong with that?
Had the district attorney looked into it, he would have found out that it's a dismissed and sealed matter, and he would not be privy to any of that information, and he certainly shouldn't have been sharing it with the general public. Because again, it defeats the purpose of a dismissed and sealed document and case if somebody of a higher power can just come out and start talking about it.
So at the beginning of your remarks, you had mentioned the Utica Police Department as well.
Yeah.
Was it somebody in UPD claiming had talked?
Again, we don't know.
The
Utica Police Department was the acting police department at the time, the arresting department. So they'd be privy to some of that information, so we don't know if they were a part of it. We are going to request, and we're going to, my attorneys are going to work closely to request the information from WIBX to find out where the initial police report came from, who submitted that document, when they submitted it to them, and then we're going to go from there.
So if it's said that the prosecutors might have attempted several times to contact your fiance, and she failed to call, return the calls or anything like that. Are you saying that's a lie?
That is not correct. Again, she reached out to them several times calling them. My attorney's aware of that. My attorney made note that she had called them on several occasions and they did not return her phone calls.
Are you still with your fiance?
Yes. As we talked about, we welcomed our first child, our daughter Genevieve, 9 months ago. Our relationship, like I stated, has never been stronger. We have one of the best relationships that a couple could have. We have such a common bond. It really was a blessing for us in our own personal lives, our own responsible lives. You know, nobody really understands what it's like to have a child until they have a child. And, you know, our bond has never been stronger. We enjoy being a parent. We enjoy everything that comes along with it. My fiance is very, very strong. I give her a lot of credit for taking care of our household and taking care of our daughter. You know, one of the things before I had my daughter, I always looked at women as equal. We were always equal. Men and women, they're absolutely equal. But you know what? Through that process of pregnancy, through that process of delivery, and now through that process of parenthood, I would have to say that women are much stronger than men, and they deserve a lot of credit for the things that they do every day.
What's your fiance's name?
Her name is Deanna.
She was with you at your announcement a couple of weeks ago.
Correct, yep.
Oh, what's her last name?
DiNardo, DiNardo.
So do you think that, if you believe all these things, you're well within your right to share them.
Absolutely.
Just as much as anybody is within their right to share them about somebody else they might know these things about. How do you think the public is going to take this stuff? Because at some point, what you laid out here, if true, is very disturbing. And ultimately, there's going to be a point where it's going to be determined at some point whether it's true or false. But at this point right now, you threw out a lot of allegations without really due process, I guess, fairness for anybody else that you've just identified. How do you think the public is going to perceive your reaction, I guess, to what might have been a case that you could have easily said, yeah, that happened, we're moving on, I'm going to focus on the issues of the campaign?
I think the general public, we're in a very small community. I think there's so many people that know about these situations. There will be several whistleblowers, I'm sure, that will come forward with information about these allegations. Again, people know, and people want to hear it. People want to hear the truth. They're sick and tired of the political rhetoric. They're sick and tired of the longtime incumbency. And they're sick and tired of the political corruption. From Albany all the way to Utica, the corruption is deep. What they do in their personal lives, but it's not really personal when it impacts victims who work or are under the purview of their power. And I think that people really want to hear that story. That's a movement across the country. Look what's happened in states all across the country. Look what's happened in Washington. Look at the abuse of power against females. This is very, very serious. This is what the Me Too movement's all about. It's all about protecting females and other victims who have been victimized by people of power and have abused their power. These people are in office for so many years. Look, the county executive's been in office 12 and a half years. The district attorney's been there, I believe, about 12 years as well. The longer these people stay in power, and again, that's why I call for term limits, is they start to get sloppy, they start to do things that are unbecoming, and sometimes they don't realize that what they're doing is a crime. And we need to bring those things to light. We need to get more people involved in the process, and we need to put issues like these to rest.
You claim that the county executive had an affair with a female staffer. When do you claim that happened?
Again, we're gonna withhold those dates for the protection of the integrity of the case.
Was it last year? Was it 2 years ago?
I just wouldn't want to comment on the dates for the integrity of the case.
What about Gerald Fiorini?
When
that happened?
Same situation. I just don't want to give away information that I'd like the authorities to dig into. If we start mentioning dates, certain documents may be redacted, and things could start to disappear, so we're not going to mention things.
You also claimed that there was a business deal that was brokered out of what you claim to be the Fiorini affair. What business deal was that?
Again, that's a particular case that we're going to have to give to the authorities.
So when, in reaction to the story we put up this weekend, we asked for comment, and you had kind of indicated you were going to probably sue. Do you think this opens you up for liability?
Absolutely not. The people that hold office, especially when we have tangible proof, are held to a much higher standard, and we are protected as individuals to bring that information forward. Otherwise, democracy would fail. The United States would fail. All of these people who have committed these crimes in public power, at some point somebody had to come forward and allege these incidences, and that's why America is so great, because we protect our people.
Also, your reference to the Me Too movement. Let's just say that what you're saying is true. If it was consensual, is there a victim you're making an allegation.
Yeah, there's absolutely a victim. Just because oftentimes it looks on the surface that it's consensual doesn't mean that it's actually consensual. As I've alluded to, these people are of power and influence. So when it looks like it's consensual, a lot of times these people are using their power and influence over these victims to get what they truly want, and it looks like it's consensual, but it's not often consensual.
Should that be determined by you or the person who was involved?
That should be determined by the person involved as well as the proper authorities to investigate the case.
So where do you go from here today?
Today, we're asking for the media to put this information out. We will then work with our attorneys and work with our local media, as well as with the investigating departments. We will supply them with the information, but they are going to have to be willing, ready, and able to be involved in the investigative process.
Who are the investigating agencies?
So, again, what I've talked about is I'm pushing the Oneida County District Attorney's Office, as well as the New York State Attorney General's Office, as well as the U.S. Federal Prosecution.
Is there a reason why you had this press conference here at City Hall?
Someplace warm to have it where we wouldn't get kicked out. You know, the people of Utica are good people. Politicians, although we may have our disagreements, tend to be much more embracing of the public, and so this was a good opportunity to have it here. We felt if we had it at the county office building, we would certainly be thrown out onto the street.
When will you be submitting materials over to those agencies?
As soon as the agencies are willing to accept it or when our attorneys state that it's time to do that and that we've gathered all of the information that we want to submit.
But if there was enough information that you want to submit, would that constitute having a press conference today?
That's kind of up to the attorneys to decide whether or not we have enough information that will solidify the case. Again, these are allegations. We believe that there are some truths to the allegations, and now it's up to the process to unfold and for the authorities to decide if it, like you said, if it's enough information. But we're going to certainly submit what we have when we feel as if we've got enough information for them. And as the case unfolds, we'll continue to submit more information. I'm sure there may be other victims, there may be other people that will come forward.
You just indicated that you had evidence of all three of these cases. But in answering his question just now, you said you believe there could be some truths.
Because these are allegations, so
you don't know that you don't have evidence of this. You're just
we do have evidence, but as true as to our law in this country, everybody is innocent until proven guilty.
What kind of materials for each of these allegations have you compiled?
Again, names, dates, circumstances, contracts, things like that. Those will all be given to the authorities. Any other questions?
Have you had a conversation with the district attorney since this unfolded at WIBF?
Absolutely not. No, at the advice of our attorneys, we should not talk to people that are in a compromising situation where they may be subject to legal issues or may be subject to the investigation itself.
Does that mean you won't come on the show?
I'm just going to skip that question. Any questions? Any questions from the OD? Nothing? All right. Thank you, gentlemen, for being here today. Hope everybody has a good day. Thank you.